It was the most important hour in the history of nuclear power. Several bad decisions made a reactor critically unstable within just an hour. Poor design, poor choices, poor sense of responsibility. This is how it all happened. I hope this is the final episode about the RBMK, for now at least. I'm eager to introduce you to all the new series that we've been working on for some weeks now. In this episode, I'm picking the subject up exactly where I left off previously. It was around 40 minutes before the Chernobyl disaster happened. The reactor was producing about 5% of the minimum power necessary to perform the test, and the operators decided to proceed even though the RBMK was experiencing xenon poisoning, which I explained in the previous video. There would be much technical talk, so I will try to sum it up in an easy way and without some details, if they are not crucial to the story in my opinion. The whole subject is material for more than a few books, so I believe you will forgive me for some simplifications or omitting minor details in order to present you a greater picture well enough. So, let's start. RBMK Design and History, Part 12. The final moments before the disaster. The reactor was being unpredictable. The xenon poisoning was enduring because of the low reactivity level. It stopped the burn-off of xenon 135, and thus, the RBMK couldn't reach the necessary power output. The operators should postpone the test, but their orders were clear. Do it, or face the consequences. Their choice was simple. Either follow the safety procedures, shut down the reactor, and wait until the xenon poisoning fades away. Or, ignore the clear signs of problems with the RBMK and proceed with the test. They chose the second option. To gain the power output that could reach the levels needed for the test, they had to increase the reactivity. The only thing that they could do in that situation was to withdraw the control rods. They decided to do that slowly, manually raising them up. That was most probably done by Leonid Toptunov, who was supervised directly by Alexander Akimov, chief of the night shift in the Chernobyl Nuclear Power Plant Unit 4. At first, this worked without any significant and unpredictable outcome. The power slowly rose. About 39 minutes past midnight, the reactor restored its output. It rose from about 30 megawatts to 160 megawatts. But despite that small step forward, the issues with xenon poisoning remained. The control rods were withdrawn to a high level, still within what was considered a normal operating limit though. Operational reactivity margin, or ORM, required more than 15 rods inserted. So we may be quite sure that the operators didn't withdraw all of the control rods yet. The next 20 minutes passed, and the reactivity still rose slowly. The reactor reached about 200 megawatts, which was still 500 megawatts below the minimum level of power output needed for the test. To understand that despite the first success, it was overall a very dangerous situation, I have to underline some details. The reactor was operating on a very low power level, for an RBMK that is. The poisoning level, on the other hand, was high. We have to add the unstable core temperatures and modified coolant flow. We also can't forget the possible instability of neutron flux, which partially was an effect of the size of the RBMK reactor. The whole unit of the power plant was not only a control room and a reactor room. There were also other sections where more operators worked and watched the process. the staff at the control room received many repeated emergency signals, including those from the computers overseeing the reactor core processes. As I mentioned before, the operators could ignore them as the readings were often misleading, incomplete, or even contradictory to what their own calculations and observations suggested. This could be one of the reasons they didn't put much faith in the emergency signals, especially keeping in mind that they were already operating outside the safe limits because of the xenon poisoning. They could just decide that the signals are wrong or over-exaggerated, and additionally, they knew that the test had a priority, so nothing should interfere. Also, the control room received information on the low levels of one half of the steam/water separator drums, as well as drum separator pressure warnings. To counter this, they triggered a rapid supply of feed water. Because of that, the relief valves opened to get rid of excess steam into a turbine condenser. Remember what was said in HBO's Chernobyl by Valery Legasov? The processes inside the reactor are like a dance, and the operators are responsible for maintaining the balance. Whatever they have done, got a response from the reactor or coexisting systems. Then they reacted to those responses, which generated another ones. Given the choices they made at Chernobyl, the vicious cycle started. We can debate where and when could or should they stop. But every single decision added up to the final effect. The Chernobyl disaster. Let's break this cycle down as simple as we can. First, they should shut down the reactor. They didn't. They further removed more control rods to increase reactivity, suspecting the xenon poisoning. Even if they didn't suspect it, they should, because that was a fairly simple and well-known situation which was probable given how the reactor worked, priming the accident. They restarted the preparations for the test when the power output was around 200 megawatts, 500 megawatts less than the required level. The reactivity went up slowly, the power output was rising, but they had to counter additional responses of the reactor and other systems. One of the first was the rise of the temperature. When reactivity goes up, so does the temperature. To keep the reactor within the right spectrum, they had to increase the coolant supply. To do that, as the test required, they activated two additional pumps. It lowered the overall core temperature and reduced the steam voids in the core, which were already there, and that was a normal sign. But the water absorbs nutrients better than steam, which means the reactivity went down. In other words, the neutron flux decreased. In this situation, the operators had to increase it again by removing additional control rods manually. It was at that moment that the ORM, operational reactivity margin, was not met. The inserted number of control rods fell below the minimum of 15. Remember, the ORM is based on a calculation, and because of the rods can go up and down, the requirement of 15 means the equivalent of 15 fully inserted rods, not exactly the number that actually is inserted into the core. Making it easier, imagine having 150 control rods. If all of them would be inserted into the core at 10%, the overall ORM would be 15. Also, if the 135 would be fully withdrawn and 15 would be fully inserted, the ORM would also be 15. We can call the ORM inserted rod worth. Of course, it's not exactly how this is calculated, but I wanted to explain that to you in an easier way. Then again, the poor design let know of itself. The operators couldn't know the inserted rod worth in real time, because the RBMK systems didn't have any instruments that could precisely measure it. Simply speaking, they had to rely on their own calculations, while at this particular moment, they were probably stressed a lot, by both performing the test and by the possible xenon poisoning. All of these decisions made the reactor extremely unstable. Almost all of the 211 control rods have been removed manually from the reactor core. Additionally, the coolant flow was excessively high, which meant it was close to the boiling point when it reached the reactor. So, the vicious cycle continued. The RBMK design had a positive void coefficient when the reactivity was low. This meant the bubbles of steam, the voids, were created from boiling water, the coolant that was supplied to the core. Why was it so important? The operators didn't know and didn't have any instruments to be warned about this, that the overall state of the reactor was so poor that these voids were not counterbalanced by the reactivity effects. This meant the number of steam bubbles, the voids, was increasing. And because steam has a lower neutron absorption rate than water, the chain reaction of all mentioned effects could mean that at one point, the flux will not be kept in check by the means that lower the reactivity. Reactor number 4 was at that moment at a huge risk of getting out of hand. Nothing made the operators suspect that the increase in reactivity could soon go up without any restraints. In these conditions, in that particular situation, the test has begun. It was approximately 1 a.m., 23 minutes and 4 seconds. The coolant was supplied to the reactor with 8 pumps. 4 of them were powered by the turbine, and 4 from the grid as normal. As the test required, operators shut the steam off, and because of that, the turbine generator could not supply the 4 pumps. Diesel generators took that role on themselves, but they needed some short time to accelerate. The water flow rate decreased significantly, which then led to increased formation of steam voids in the coolant, which was flowing up the fuel pressure tubes. As I said, steam does not slow down the reactivity as well as water, so the chain reaction started. The reactivity rises, the xenon is burnt off, the control rods remain withdrawn. Around 1 a.m., 23 minutes and 40 seconds, the Scala system recorded that the scrum procedure was initiated. One of the operators used the AZ5 button. All of the control rods began to be inserted into the reactor core simultaneously, about 40 centimeters per second, so it took about 18 to 20 seconds for them to be fully inserted, as the full height of the core was around 7 meters. A few seconds after using the AZ5, a huge power spike occurred and the core overheated, which caused some of the fuel rods to fracture. From 200 megawatts, reached within 20-30 minutes before, the power output now jumped to 530 megawatts in a mere 3 seconds. The graphite tips of the control rods reached the water-filled reactor and made the water vaporize instantly. The power output for the Unit 4 RBMK-1000 was supposed to operate on around 3200 megawatts. The last reading could be as high as more than 30,000 megawatts. It was at that moment the first explosion happened. The only probable reason behind the destruction of the reactor core was a steam explosion. Every system was filled with steam within a fraction of a second. Imagine a tire pumped with air. When you reach a certain point, the tire just explodes. 2 or 3 seconds later, another explosion followed. It was more powerful because the destroyed reactor core came into contact with the oxygen. It immediately terminated the nuclear chain reaction, but also exposed the remains of the RBMK core. It ejected the parts of both the reactor and reactor building into the air, scattering the irradiated debris around a big area. All of this resulted in the biggest nuclear disaster in human history. This is why today we all know the name Chernobyl. Thanks for watching. I think this might be the longest episode of the RBMK Design and History miniseries. I hoped you enjoyed it as much as I did. I purposely didn't mention what happened after the explosion. This is a subject that we have to divide into many different sections. Some have to be dedicated to particular people, some to groups of them, and some to the technical and scientific aspects of the accident's effects. Leave a comment and share our videos if you think they're worth it. In the meantime, wait for the next episode, which will start a new miniseries. Take care, stay safe, and see you next week.